Welcome to Inside the Islanders. I'm George Matthews. With me, the head coach and the general manager of the Charlottetown Islanders, Jim Hulton. We did an interview here earlier on, Jim, about three or four months ago. But when we do this interview right now, your hockey club sitting sixth overall in the Quebec Major Junior Hockey League, 13 games over 500. Now, at the start of the year, your club goes 1-6, and then all of a sudden goes on a run. Now, over the last 31 games, your team an outstanding 26-4-1. Now, I know at the start of the year that you did not believe that your team was a 1-6 team. I'm not sure whether you believe they're a 26-4-1 team here right now, but over the first half of the season, it could not get much better than this for your hockey club, Jim.
No, it certainly doesn't. I think it's safe to say it's a very, very pleasant surprise. None of us really knew heading into the season what was going to unfold. The one thing we were confident of was that it would be a highly competitive group that would have strong goaltending and strong leadership. Unbeknownst to us, I think, is the immense effect that those two elements have had, the goaltending and the leadership. And it's been a really, really fun group to watch progress. They're certainly an enjoyable group to coach. They're an enjoyable group to watch. They play hard for each other on almost every night, and they've been extremely consistent, and the results have followed.
Now, and of course, you've got Chris Abbott, of course, with Eastlink TV, calling your name Hulton's Hustlers, which is a pretty descriptive term, of course, of how your hockey club plays this year. But for yourself, your coaching staff with Guy and as well Brad McKenzie, Guy Girard, it's a huge compliment to when you get the type of discussion around the league that this club is hard to beat, shows up each and every night, is prepared to play, and competes each and every night. As a coaching staff, you have to be pleased with that type of description.
Well, it is, but it's a credit to our people, first and foremost. Guy and Brad don't get enough credit. Kevin, Spider, Tyler, everybody contributes to the atmosphere around here, and I think it's been just that. We've enjoyed the underdog role. I think everyone picked us to finish in last place, primarily because they were looking at the faces that were leaving, not the faces that were staying, and that's a natural given the star power that we had last year. But I can't beat the drum enough about our leadership. Getson, Akin, Joseph, Welsh, these guys set the bar from day one, and they almost come in on a daily basis, and it's a short-term memory. Let's not get too high on the wins, not get too down on the losses. And the attitude didn't change at 1-6-1, and it hasn't changed here now. And I think that's been a big recipe to success. And they work hard every day, and they work hard, and they have fun with each other. And every group sets out at the start of the season. Your goal is always to be the hardest-working team in the league. There's 20 teams or 18 teams that say that. Usually there's only one that gets the mantelpiece. It's nice to be a contender for that title.
You talk about that leadership group and a lot of it coming back next year potentially as well. But Pascal Akin, a huge turnaround on this season when, of course, he was suspended earlier on for a number of games, I think 6 or 7 games. He comes back and he's been a huge part here as well.
Well, he has. You're starting to see a man amongst boys type of scenario with Pascal. He's a big, strong player. And yeah, evident out of the gate when we didn't have him there, how much we missed him. And his confidence is growing in leaps and bounds. I mean, he's the one guy coming back off the Christmas break. Normally, there's a little bit of a lapse and a lull from players, but that's where you can see the age difference. The 20-year-old players, he knows that the league goes to a different level. And I thought his game has risen here since the Christmas break, and that's saying something because they had a terrific first half.
And, of course, when you take a look at this club as well, again, many people, and there was a huge lineup that said this team might finish last in the Quebec Major Junior Hockey League, currently sitting sixth. I don't think there's a bigger story here in the Quebec Major Junior Hockey League than what we're seeing going on here in Charlottetown this year. Now, one of the factors here to help have this team play better at this point of the season has been your use of free agency coming from Ontario. Currently, the roster has about 7 kids from Ontario. Now, this is not an easy job to get players here, and it's costly from an ownership perspective as well. These players are not free wallets, and they got to go through waivers and whatever, and it costs to bring a team or a player from the Ontario Hockey League to the Quebec Major Junior Hockey League. But each one of these players, they fit in. They have added to the depth of the organization. Not that they're all superstars, but certainly that depth has allowed you to compete even better.
Well, it certainly has, and this is part of a plan that dates back to the trade deadline a year ago when we were aggressively pursuing what we did in terms of that. We knew there was going to be some holes, and we tried to look at some historical precedent in the league, and St. John being the most recent one. Darryl Young did this in a kind of a bridge year, so to speak. He gapped some of the differences in draft choices through free agency. So we set it with a bit of an aggressive pursuit this summer. We had a free agency camp in Kingston, Ontario. Looked at a lot of different options. you know, a lot of it comes down to luck and timing, and we've had a little bit of both on our side this year. We thought we could bridge the gap until we reacquired some of the draft picks, which has happened. A lot of them were frozen, and there was conditions and a multitude of different factors there. But we've had major contributions from a lot of guys out of Ontario. And I think if you look at the Maritime teams in particular, a lot of the teams are setting their sights and being aggressive in that market. So it's something that we'll continue to pursue.
Of course, when you get players like that, and there's a lot of good players in Ontario, they all can't play in the Ontario Hockey League. It just opens up more doors for the types of players that we've seen here.
Well, it certainly does. I mean, it comes down to pure population numbers. If you look at the talent pool and the number of players that are available out of Ontario versus the Maritimes in Quebec, it stands to reason that there's some good players that slip through the cracks. And there's numerous examples in our league in the last 5-10 years of kids that have come down, maybe got passed over, didn't get the opportunity in Ontario, but have been late bloomers and had a lot of success here. So we're always on the outlook for those types of guys.
Of course, goaltending is always a storyline. It's a great storyline if you've got it. Not so good if you don't. But goaltender Matty Welsh, as I said to you just before we did this interview, usually great goaltending has great coaching. Great coaching has great goaltending. Right now, the combination of the both here right now fitting very nicely with Matty Welsh confident in how his team plays inside his own blue line. He knows what that he can play the shooter and not have to worry about rebounds. Other guys are going to be covered up. All that in the mix here. But Matty Welsh has been just simply an outstanding goaltender here.
Well, he certainly has clear-cut MVP in our team from start to finish. He's on such a roll right now, and his confidence has kind of matched up to his natural ability. And combine that with an excellent work ethic and a great relationship with our goaltending coach, Paul Drew, and you're seeing the culmination of 2.5 years of work here. And part of the plan moving into the summer was the hopes that Matt was ready to take the mantle of number one. You never know for certain in this business whether the kid is ready at a certain time, but he certainly has. He's been terrific, and the nice part is we build our confidence from Matt on out, and you can see that in games. We're sometimes a little bit slow start, but as soon as we know that Welsh is on his game, which is usually 99% of the time, we're pretty lucky. And yes, we play a different style this season. We knew coming into the season that the goals against column was going to be the most important one for us. We weren't going to score at will, kind of like we did a year ago, but as a result, we're a harder team to play against. We don't give up as many grade A chances. It is somewhat easier to be a goaltender in that system, but by the same token, you still have to make the saves, and he's done it night in, night out.
Well, of course, a number here, I'm not sure whether you're aware of it or not, when you score three, you're 19-0-1 in the season. Have not lost in regulation time when you score three. Scoring three is huge here, and that, of course, that gets down to whether your goaltending can, in fact, shut the opponent down. But you decide with that... as far as league scoring is concerned, you're 13th in the league as well. You decide to add to the scoring of your hockey club over the Christmas break. Now, last year, and I'm going to nickname you Jolton Jim Hulton here, for the trading opportunities that you've taken advantage of over the last couple of years, almost changed your roster 50% last year for a team that finishes in the top 10 in the country in the CHL. Looked like this year you were going to stay relatively quiet, but you make three huge acquisitions, all adding... you're hoping for anyway, to your scoring and as well helping your power play as well.
Well, exactly. We went into the deadline with the hopes of maybe improving in the short term without affecting the long term. We knew that we had to address the power play. Power play has been one of the weaker points of our club, tied in with overall offense. And I think if you looked at the numbers, just as you alluded to, if we can get to three, we're not looking at having to score five goals a night. But I think as we get down the stretch here, things tighten up. You have to have a few more naturals in your lineup, and in particular on the power play. And we were sorely lacking in right shots all over the ice, in particular up front and on the power play. So the opportunity to fill the third overage spot materialized with Askew. We kind of knew the price on that. We got a little bit creative with Quebec. Cost us two good hockey players, but I think it was a good old-fashioned hockey trade. Essentially ended up being Grouchy and McLeod for Gentil and Askew. The age is way out with Grouchy and Gentil, both 99, so that covers us off in the future. We can only keep three 98s heading into next season anyways, so really Gregor for Askew gives Gregor an opportunity to compete for a 20 spot somewhere else. And then we didn't really anticipate the Hardy deal coming down until the 11th hour, but that's what happens here at the deadline. And again, just an opportunity. Sam Eisenheimer gave us wonderful, wonderful minutes. It's just a little bit different look of a guy who's a little bit more of a natural scorer, we think, and hopefully we'll provide that. And then one of the most pleasant surprises at Christmas was a gift, I guess, in the form of Brett Belgill, our first draft pick from last year's draft. fortunately, we'd kept a relationship alive, and things weren't working out for him well south of the border. And he's come in and certainly contributed early on.
Well, when you talk about Brett Budgell as well, a huge get for the franchise, because this young player last year was talked about as potentially being a top 10 draft pick. You got him in the second round. There's talk about the NCAA. That's a hard wall to go up against. But when you're a major junior franchise, when you compete against the NCAA, you just have to work hard. And for the player that comes here, he's coming to a winning program, and his education costs are going to be looked after just like he was if he, in fact, he was playing in the NCAA.
Well, it certainly is, and it was a long process, but we knew that when we drafted Brett. It's a credit to our scouting staff. Patrick Lachance is no longer with us. He's been promoted to Calgary, but he and Trevor Burt watched him a lot. Figured it was worth the gamble at pick number 25, knowing that it was going to be a bit of a sales pitch. Can't say enough, even dating back to the question about free agency, is our ownership has really stepped to the forefront here and allowed us the latitude, whether it be financially or just the support, to be able to pursue this. There's a lot of ownership situations that wouldn't have allowed you to pick a guy in the first pick that might not show up. It sounds easy to do when he materializes, but it's not an easy thing for a franchise to sit back when he doesn't report. But we had the luxury of ownership that had a vision. We had a management staff that I think were willing to work at it in the long haul. And fortunately for us, we got a little bit lucky and it worked out.
Just a final question or two here, Jim, as far as going over the last half of the schedule here for your hockey club right now. As we talk, you are 13 games over 500 here after getting a 1-6 start. And again, as I said, 26-4-1 over your last 31 games as well. But the future looking really strong here in the second half for the Charlottetown Islanders, and moving on into next season as well, because you potentially could have 12, 13, 14, 15 players returning off this roster for next season as well.
Well, one of the things we try to do is kind of recalibrate our ages. You hear a lot of talk in junior hockey, the cycles about having your ages weighed out, and a couple of the free agents, Liam Payton comes to mind as a 2000. We kind of earmarked our 2000 draft as one that needed to be propped up. But now when you're looking at a nightly basis, there's four or five kids born in year 2000. Budgell coming in as an 01. Our 99 class was very strong. You know, we've got probably a couple great internal candidates in Overage and Getson and True, who are going to be able to be two of the best 98s in the league. So we are fortunate, and again, both goaltenders eligible to come back. So we think we're set up. Again, you always hope to have your plan, and I'm sure there's 17 other teams that think their plan's in place too. The one bonus for us is that we have the Valdor first overall pick, and with them unloading, it could potentially be a lottery pick, which is exciting for all of us.
That's the head coach and as well the GM of the Charlottetown Islanders. His club, the Charlottetown Islanders, no bigger surprise story in the Quebec Major Junior Hockey League this season. For Jim, I'm George Matthews for Inside the Islanders.